Today's topic is edema. The definition of edema is as follows. It is defined as a palpable swelling caused by increase in interstitial fluid volume. The body fluid is divided into two compartments. One is intracellular, another one is extracellular. Extracellular fluid is further divided into intravascular fluid and interstitial fluid. Now, when excess of fluid is accumulated in the interstitial space or extracellular space, a part of extracellular space, then it is called as edema. Edema is not clinically apparent or it is not visible until the interstitial fluid volume increases by 2.5 to 3 liters. What causes edema? Edema means excess of fluid collection in the interstitial space. So, when the capillaries leak out, then the fluid will seep from the capillary to the interstitial space. Let us see the mechanism of formation of edema. This is very important because edema is a symptom and not a disease. It is a symptom showing some underlying disease like heart disease or kidney failure or loss of protein in the urine, etc. So mechanisms are summarized as follows. First, you can see that it is due to increased capillary hydrostatic pressure. Any reason which increases the capillary water pressure will force water to seep into the interstitial space. Next mechanism is reduced plasma oncotic pressure, that means reduced amount of protein or albumin in the blood will also cause edema, that means the fluid will move out from the intravascular chamber or intravascular area to the interstitial space. Third is increased blood volume, blood vessel wall permeability, that means capillary leakage. It is seen in any kind of inflammation and injury. Then obstruction of fluid clearance in the lymphatic system. If the lymph channels are blocked, that means then there will be edema. It is seen in tumors. It is seen in some of the disease like filaria, etc. Then changes in the water retaining properties of the tissues themselves. This is also one of the mechanism. Mostly hydrostatic pressure or capillary hydrostatic pressure is increased in case of kidney disease. Then let us see the risk factors associated with edema. The risk factors are the mild cases without any underlying pathology. If the patient does not have any underlying disease like kidney or heart disease or any major illness, then the cause of edema, which is mostly seen in the lower extremity, it is because of sitting or staying in one position for too long, eating too much salty food, having premenstrual sign and symptoms, and pregnancy. Edema is also due to side effect of some medications like high blood pressure medication, especially the beta blockers. It is seen that it causes some amount of water retention. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, this also causes water retention, and also it can damage the kidneys, which can cause water retention. Steroid drugs, these also causes sodium and water retention. Estrogens again causes water retention, certain diabetes medications. Then the main cause of edema, this is important. This is a major cause of edema. One is congestive heart failure, where you can see clearly edema. Inadequate lymphatic system circulation. Then weakness or damage to the veins of the legs. In the lower extremities, if the veins are damaged, that or the valves are damaged, then means that means the venous return will not be proper and there will be lot of accumulation of blood in the lower extremity. So the hydrostatic pressure is also increased and it can therefore then kidney damage, kidney disease, cirrhosis of liver causes ascites. In that also there is loss of protein or less protein in the body due to and in cirrhosis ascites can be seen. It is also a form of edema. And long term protein deficiency reduces plasma oncotic pressure, and so the person especially seen in small children that the child looks edematous. Then next is classification of edema. Depending upon the site of collection, there is generalized edema or localized edema. Generalized edema means in the whole body gets affected, and that is large amount of fluid when it is collected throughout the body. It is called as anasarca. There is one another terminology called as anasarca. That means large generalized edema. And localized edema can be due to lymphedema, DVT, cellulitis, trauma, etc. Then use of beta blockers, etc. Then how we are approaching, how we are doing the management of a patient with edema. First we have to see whether there is any underlying disease or not. Next we have to see whether there is venous obstruction or lymphatic obstruction or not. Now in classification of edema, you can say that it is also classified as pitting edema, non-pitting edema. Normally due to water retention in the extremities, it is the edema which is seen is pitting. Non-pitting edema is when the skin does not form any depression. If you are putting pressure over the skin, it is not forming any depression. That is non-pitting edema. Normally it is due to due to lymphatic system which gets blocked, then that edema is non-pitting. Or mixed edema, it is also one of the thyroid disorders. In that also the edema is non-pitting. So in pitting edema, when pressure is applied to a small area, the indentation persists for some time. That is, the depression persists for some time after the release of pressure. Peripheral pitting edema is most common type due to water retention. It is also due to any type of systemic disease, heart disease, kidney disease, pregnancy, or local conditions like varicose vein, thromboflebitis, insect bite, dermatitis. Non-pitting edema, as I have already said, there is no depression in the skin, no indentation of the skin. It is associated with such conditions like lymphedema, lipodema, mixed edema. Let us see how edema can be measured. 0 plus no pitting edema, mild pitting edema, 1 plus 2 millimeter depression that disappears rapidly. 2 plus can be given in moderate pitting edema, that means 4 mm depression that disappears in 10 to 15 seconds. 3 plus moderately severe pitting edema, 6 millimeter depression that may last more than 1 minute. 4 plus severe pitting edema, 8 mm depression that can last more than 2 minutes. The complications of edema are: untreated edema can cause painful swelling with pain that gets worse, stiffness and difficulty in walking, stretched and itchy skin, infection in the area of swelling, scarring between the layer of tissue. This is all because of poor circulation. Then poor blood circulation, loss of elasticity in arteries, veins and joints. if the edema is not treated, and also loss of elasticity in artery veins causes edema. Then ulcerations on the skin. Medical management of edema include drugs, corrections of underlying medical problem, reducing symptoms like dyspnea. In large amount of edema, like large pleural effusion or ascites can cause dyspnea. So that in that condition, we have to relieve the problem of dyspnea by removing the excess amount of fluid which is collected, which is causing edema. Then reduce the pain related to edema because it causes pressure on the nerves. Reduce the injury that is due to edema, because the skin is more stretched and shiny and it is prone for injury, the edematous skin. So skin care is important. Then control of infection is also important, the skin infection especially, because infection from dermatophytes, streptococcus. Then to reduce edema symptomatically, we have to elevate the extremity, compression stocking can be used, reduction in the salt intake. The management includes, we have to treat proteinuria if it is the cause of edema, because proteinuria, heavy level of proteinuria causes hypoalbuminemia, and less amount of albumin is also due to malnutrition. It is seen in children, so treat malnutrition. Now let us see the nursing management. Assess the presence of worsening of edema. Encourage adherence to sodium restriction. When indicated, encourage rest period. Monitor the client response to diuretics. Check daily weight. Monitor the rate of parenteral fluids and the client response. Teach self-monitoring of the weight intake and output. This is important. Turn and position the client frequently. Help the patient to relax, promote oxygenation, place the patient in high Fowler position, then administer oxygen, assess the patient's condition frequently, auscultate the lung field or breath field for cracklings, because crackles indicate effusion or fluid accumulation in the pulmonary area. Then watch for complications of treatment like electrolyte depletion in case of diuretics, because diuretics causes potassium loss. Then monitor ABG result for the presence of hypoxemia and hypercapnia.